So we have another monologue, From Thought to Action by Sachin Kelkar, Head Asia-Pac Scale Program, Intel Software and Services Group. In this role, he focuses on developing the software market across Asia-Pacific by working with key software companies and software developers. Sachin drives business relationships and developer engagements with independent software vendors, ISVs, system integrators and software developers in the region across consumer and enterprise segments. Sachin has worked with Intel for 9 years. Prior to Intel, Sachin has worked in Microsoft and Citrix and has an experience of 18 years in software and telecom industry. Let's welcome Sachin.
Thank you very much. While we are setting it up, I think it's been a pretty interesting day. We started with some amazing speeches in the morning. Well, Ravi Gururaj mentioned about the disruptions, and then we had some wonderful workshops on innovation and a lot of ideas on how to do it. What I'm going to do is share with some of the practical tools, practical ways of making this work. And as startups, as companies who are trying to create new products or new services, I think this becomes very interesting because it's okay to have so much of jargon thrown at you, but if you have something which is very quick, very easy to really practice it, very easy to kind of get it working, I think that's where the real interesting part is. So as a part of our team, so as a part of our team, what we're doing is we are engaged in a philosophy called design thinking workshops. And ideas to kind of bring out this to the entire new age ecosystem and see how we can really learn and work together. So normally this is a topic for a 3-hour workshop, but I'm trying to condense it in a 20-minute window and see how best I can do the justice to this particular topic. So I think this is what I'm going to talk about, from the thought of the entire design thinking, innovation, in actually bringing it to practice. So that's the idea of thought to action. Now, these are the three things which I'm going to touch briefly, basically understand what is design thinking. Now, we had a very interesting topic earlier to talk about the design as a principle in terms of user experience. But I'm going to step ahead and actually define the design thinking as a methodology, as a process to really evolve the problem-solving techniques. Then we'll talk about some stories, some examples, because that those are the ideas where you'll probably kind of get very close to as what you are also doing also. And we also heard from a person from G, and I'm going to take an example from G as well. And then ideas to then see how you can actually put into practice. I think those are three things which will probably do it the next 15-20 minutes time. Now, I think all of you will be agree that innovation is just not like a spark of lightning bolt, which just kind of strikes us one fine night and voila, there's like innovation on the ground. It's a kind of systematic process. It's a step-by-step process where most of us are involved in really understanding the problem and then taking it to a logical conclusion, finding the right, the most interesting solution. So it's safe to assume that innovation is a process, and I'll probably add the word in the bracket, which is a design process, because you are actually making it work with a specific design flow in mind. Though you are not probably visualizing that fashion, but it's true. And as we look at the different steps of it, you'll probably agree with me that which are the steps which are normally following in the entire course of innovation in our entire enterprise. It could be product design, it could be process design, doesn't matter what product line or what business you are in. This process becomes a very interesting way to understand and then implement it as we move on. Does anybody know who this gentleman is? Any guesses? Thomas Edison, yes, that's right. I think he was maybe the pioneer of this entire concept. Maybe he was not the guy who coined the term, but as a engineer, as a practitioner, he has been doing this way, way long. And if you look at his model, he was not the sole innovator or sole inventor. He was a guy which has a lot of collaborative teams put together. And he was really doing things with a specific user-centered approach. And for him, it was okay to fail, because that's where kind of his philosophy was, that it's not about failing once or twice or 1,000 times. I kind of really discovered myself how I can things do better. I think that was his philosophy. So this can be like a pioneer or the father figure of the entire process. Over the last few years, I'm sure IDEO, Stanford, all of them have contributed to this entire principle of design thinking, and we are kind of sharing from some thoughts from them as well. To sum up, the definition of design thinking is very simple. It's a very human-centered, your target customer-centered, creative, iterative process. Obviously, it has to be backed up by a feasibility on technology side and a business model side. But idea is that find that practical approach to really find the best and most suitable idea. And as we do this, I'm sure you will kind of flare up tons of ideas through the ideation process and whatever you want to call it. And then ultimately focus on which is very useful, meaningful for your business, your service, and then make it work in the world. I think that's what I would probably sum up as the definition of design thinking. Now, obviously, you need to evolve certain mindset to make this work. It's not that you will kind of start practicing it just like that. These are the very simple mindset rules which are essential to follow this practice. And again, there's no rocket science that you need to focus on human values. I remember the word which I saw in the presentation before this, the user interface design, the word was empathize. I think this is a very, very interesting word. Unless you understand the user to the fullest, empathize with his values, his motives, his needs, you're not able to create a solution, a product, or whatever you want to call it for that particular user. After that, definitely you need to embrace experimentation, not just a word of on the paper, but try it out, show things in action, and then use that as a feedback and make it work. So use that as a complete cycle to iterate the entire model of what you want to create. And at each point of this model or each point of this process, you need to be aware of these five or six mindsets. In our workshops, we actually practice these different mindsets through a variety of steps. So obviously you will be probably just looking at this point of time, but in a workshop model, we'll actually give you tools, we'll give you actually problems to solve, and then make you actually wear these mindsets as you move on to the workshops. So this is the process for design thinking, which is a five-step process, is an iterative process. The first block is empathize, which is really understand the user motivations, his needs, by observing, by interacting, by interviewing the user, so that you can really understand what are his problem statements. A lot of times we make a mistake that we set up with a problem statement which we want to solve for the world, and in reality, the problem is not that what you have set for yourself. The problem is somewhere else, and that's where the empathize will be useful in actually zeroing on the right problem statement for what you are going to do with. The second part is defining some kind of point of view to really understand what is that objective you're going to sort for. What is that you're really going after to solve a problem? And that is very critical because point of views can come from different ways. It can be a problem statement. It could be a user, both implicit and explicit needs, and also your assumptions about what the user wants to do. So it kind of really create that as a point of view. Once you start with that definition of the problem statement or a point of view, then you can ideate. Then you can flare your imagination and your team's work to really create multiple ideas. And then start focusing on them by looking at the user definitions, by looking at what user wants, and see if you can create some rapid prototypes. And in a workshop, you can actually create prototypes by using simple stationary material. You don't have to spend $500,000 to create most expensive and comprehensive prototypes, which may fail also. It's perfectly fine to create drawing board, maybe use some kind of duct tape and paper boards and charts. Create a rapid prototype, show to user, get the feedback. Even if it fails, there's no cost really to bear upon. You can really move to the next prototype and then make it work again and again. So essentially, prototyping and testing with the user will give you that comfort and get that idea validated much, much before even you start your product manufacture design in reality. So this entire process will definitely give you three or four very clear deliverables. Definitely you are taking into consideration your customers' needs and their requirements much, much ahead of the curve. You're also flaring up a lot of options which you can try it out. You're also zeroing on which will work eventually. That means you're also looking at kind of cutting down the risk of really putting that whatever X amount of million dollars in actually prototyping the real product. And then obviously you are using this as an iterative process so that you can really try it out and knock it off. Now, what we'll do is take some examples. And again, these are all stories which I'm sure some of you must have read or heard about. Idea is that all of these guys use these principles to really make in action. I think that's where our the real talk about today, what we're going to talk about. First example, these are the five students from Stanford University. As a part of their de-thinking course, they were given a task to solve a very interesting but very serious challenge. I think all of us have seen this problem. In the world, there are lot many small babies who are born premature, and obviously because of that, they have a low birth weight. And in that situation, they can't really defend themselves from the infections and other things. And the standard practice to counter or kind of help them is to make use of something which you call it as. Anybody can guess what is the tool or mechanism to make this thing keep in control? Is something called incubator, right? Right. Now, these group of students were given a challenge that how can you really make a much more impactful use of incubators in emerging markets. And they had a focus country, which was Nepal. And obviously, they started with a basic issue that, hey, this is a very expensive instrument, $25,000 plus, and maybe the cost has to come down. So they started with a basic problem statement, how to reduce the cost of the incubator to a more affordable prices, and so on and so forth. They started doing the research on how to bring the bill of material low down, use different material, use different technology to make it work. Then they realized that they are not doing enough to really understand the problem statement. Then they said, we have a 2-week vacation. Let's go to Nepal. Let's understand the customer or the consumer who is using this. And then we'll probably see what is the real rationale behind solving this problem. As they started making visits to Nepal and with hospitals, doctors, nurses, and actual users, different things started coming out. Nepal probably had an adequate number of incubators already installed in their hospitals, so the cost was not really a problem. Still, they were not getting enough mothers and little babies to come to the hospital because the terrain was difficult, the users were staying in remote locations, and it was not physically possible to bring that baby to the hospital nearest to the nearest city. So the idea was not solving that problem of $25,000 incubator. Idea was that how can you really get that warmth to the baby who was staying in the remote location? I mean, that was the problem statement. So as you start observing the user, the problem statement changed from a cost issue to a real issue which the babies were facing. So the team started working, and they started using whatever material they had, right from the heating bags to sleeping mattresses, prototype with baby dolls, and did all kind of possible prototyping possible. And they realized that if we can really get that warmth to the mother and the baby as quickly as possible in a very effective manner, that can solve the problem. The solution eventually which came out of this entire exercise was a product called Embrace Infant Warmer. This particular warmer was made with seamless cloth or very simple material, which was very easy to fabricate. It had some kind of phase-changing wax, which will, once heated, will keep the interiors warm for a much longer time, and it was portable. And the best part was that this was done at almost 1% of the cost of the original incubator price. So essentially, the problem statement which you start and how you evolve by using the empathy as a real element of it can really do wonders. This was the story of the team which came from the Stanford University. And as a result, now they are a successful startup. Multiple stories on them have been published, and obviously thousands of lives saved because of their little invention which is now available. Let me give another example. These are two young guys, Ankit Gupta and Akshay Kothari. Anybody knows which startup they established? Again, this is from Stanford School. So these guys started in the era where iPad was really becoming like an interesting device, and they found by their interaction with users in different coffee places and campuses that consuming news was not that easy. You need to go to a website, scroll through the different web pages, and then try to figure it out where the content was. Wall Street Journal, New York Times, all these were newspaper sites were not really user-friendly in really allowing the consumer, the choice of consuming the content the way they wanted. So they sat with the users, they started prototyping with hand-drawn sheets, hand-drawn papers, iterated many ideas, and then came with the application called Pulse. I'm sure some of you must have used Pulse on your devices. Now, this became a very interesting application, and it went all the way to Steve Jobs demonstrating on stage in one of the Apple conferences. The idea was that the entire approach was possible by understanding user requirements, creating rapid prototypes in very quick and efficient manner, and then building the product based on that. So I think this is another example of how design thinking process can help you to really build a product quickly and which can be really made successful. Okay, let's come to the GE example. We heard in the morning about the different GE divisions. So this is one of the division called GE Healthcare. Now this guy here is the innovation architect, part of the GE Healthcare group. And obviously as an architect, he was very curious to understand how my products are really made useful in hospitals. So he used to kind of tour different hospitals. Now, from a product perspective, no issues. MRI machines, which he was most focused on, is a wonderful product from GE. The hospital had no complaints. The technicians had no complaints. The technology was superb, ahead of time. All the thing was great. But as he was making tours of these hospitals, he observed a very interesting scene. There was a young girl, 8-year-old girl, and she was crying hysterically because she was the next in line to get that MRI done. And her mother was also in a bad state because the kid was not very comfortable. And the doctor was called in to sedate that girl and then actually take the MRI for. Then he realized that more than 80% kids had to be sedated before they could actually go through the MRI process. How many of you have done the MRI? Or how many have actually seen the MRI for maybe your family or members, right? It's a very kind of frightening experience, right? You are got into a room which is full of very crazy looking machines, which are making a lot of noise, and then you are forced to lie still for 35, 45 minutes, whatever that time is, and then you have no clue what's happening to you. And imagine that experience which the kid is going through. Obviously, he or she is very frightened or disturbed to really go through that process. Now, Doug said that, hey, this is not what I designed this machine for. I want not only my technicians to be comfortable, but also my end customers also to be comfortable in using this entire process. So he started on the entire model of, let's understand what is that we can do to make this experience much better for that particular clientele, which is the young kid kind of target audience. Then he studied the kids' behavior. I'm sure all of you have seen, all of our kids, like, just give them a couple of chairs and a blanket. They will create wonderful ideas around it, right? They will create a spaceship, they will create a whatever, a house and a cabin or whatever they want. So essentially, the kids are very, imaginative in understanding or what they can do with little things. And I think that's what he started observing for. He went to the play parks, he went to schools, he went to kind of really understand what these kids are really looking at. One thing came out is that if you engage them in a story, which is very interesting, maybe they will be able to focus on the story and not the real action behind what's happening. So with that idea in mind, and with the prototyping material and with the kind of iterations what he did, he came with a couple of examples. Now, these are the same MRI machines which GE develops. No technology change, but he created the experience as a pirate ship or a submarine and wove a story around it. And the technicians then used to call the kids, hey, Mr. So-and-so, you are a captain of this ship. Walk up the gangway, be in the captain's deck, and you had to lie still because we are going at a warp speed. If we move, pirates will attack us. And the kid used to enjoy that because he was part of the story while something was happening in the background which he was not even bothered about. Same for the submarine. You are in submarine, and if you move, the fishes on the some kind of digital signage was there, they will get disturbed. So you had to lay still and observe the fish. So obviously there were stories which got evolved. Nothing changed from a product perspective, but the experience was very different and very involving for the kid. Now, The result was less than 10% had to be sedated, and the problem was they want to do it again. So obviously the insurance won't support that, but I think this was the kind of story. Now, what we're doing is that use this model to really evolve, and idea is that if you follow this process, this becomes much more interesting to really take that entire process into through these steps and make it work. Now, just to give a quick idea about what we do within Intel, we work with startups like you, we work with larger product companies, including large software companies like CyberLink and Mozilla, to get these ideas together and evolve new applications or new software models using this kind of technology. Let me give a couple of examples of what we have done. This is a company called CyberLink. I'm sure most of you must have seen CyberLink media player on your PCs and laptops. They are coming with a new application called Media Story, which is to really create the user experiences with photos and videos which you normally capture. And the entire development of this particular product happened and evolved through a series of workshops which we did along with CyberLink to really help them come with the ideas of what they can do with this application and then get feedback from the user and then integrate that in their entire design philosophy. So same concept, flare up, focus, iterate. I think that's how it really works. Now, just to kind of summarize, identify who your user is, talk to them, observe them, interview them, use all the possible techniques to get into that action. Establish a problem statement worth solving. It's not that what you have said initially. Establish that with the user center as a key focus area. Step away from PowerPoint, get into action, build cheap prototypes with whatever material you have. It could be anything, could be a simple stretching material to whatever you have. Don't have to kind of elaborately spend money on that. Get into a discussion, get into collaborative action. Be like Edison, what he used to do, prototype quickly, cheaply, and then even if you fail, doesn't matter. You can really pivot on, kind of work on that again. Test your ideas early, because that's where you will probably have a much better way to understand and then take the final approach of how you want to succeed in the future. So this is a quick snapshot of what we talk about as design thinking. More elaborate action happens in the workshop. Unfortunately, we couldn't do it out here, but maybe if some of you are traveling to NPC Bangalore, we'll probably try and see whether we can do a workshop there. Just to give us some idea, there's some additional material you want to kind of go and look at a later stage. Design Thinking has a course from Stanford. This is available online. There are a lot of YouTube videos, TED Talks. So go and have a look at it and start using it in your companies or your organizations. I think that's a very interesting approach of really designing a product quickly and then become more effective in connecting with the users. Okay, thank you very much.